Speciale gast vandaag op Lekker Sport is de ene en enigste Natalie de Toy. Nice to see you again.
Thank you. Thanks for having me on the show.
Die Kijknet mensen wil weet, die Kijknet kijkers wil weet of hierdie de Toy enige Afrikaans kan praten.
Ik kom eigenlijk van Afrikaanse familie af, maar I speak very little English. Afrikaans, should I say. I think traveling so much and getting to, you know, speaking mostly English, you tend to lose a bit of the Afrikaans. And so I speak mostly English, but I do obviously have family that speak Afrikaans to me.
Ons gaan hier daar Afrikaanse woordjie ingooi vandag hier so op Lekker Sport. But first question, we'll keep in English. You retired in 2012, was it?
I did, yes. Yeah. So London 2012, yeah. Paralympic Games. Mm. My last race was the 100 meter freestyle, and that was the day I retired from the sport.
Do you miss it?
I absolutely don't. You know, I think as a young kid, I had already chosen, I think, my career. And I said at the age of 28, I would have achieved absolutely everything possible in my sport so that I could go out there and still study and still work and still achieve something that other than sport and other than swimming. And so when I left the sport, I knew I'd achieved everything. And my team and I actually managed to achieve it all. So walked away knowing that I don't need to come back.
Talking about those achievements, you know, the gold medals, the awards and stuff, what is your personal greatest achievement?
You know, I think I had a dream, I think, more or less from the age of 12 to get to the Olympic Games.
Sure.
And at 14, I qualified for Commonwealth. At 16, I missed out on qualifying for the Olympic Games by 0.03 of a second. And then had a motorbike accident the very next year at age 17. So, you know, it took me a few years extra to achieve the Olympic Games, and I think that would be the ultimate, what would you call it, dream that,
sure.
that I achieved. And just lucky to have achieved it at age 24, and yeah, looking to find something else.
If you look back at that first appearance, you know, at the Olympics, was it too great? Do you remember much of it? At the moment, it must have been overwhelming.
Well, you know, I've competed at the Paralympics since 2004 in Athens, and for me it was completely overwhelming. Just being disabled, I'd never seen so many disabilities in my life before. Inspired by a lot of it, some of it I couldn't understand how, you know, they could even get into a swimming pool and swim. But you know, from there it was, I'm here to do a job and let's see what we can do. And I just swam, I trained hard, and I did my best times and I broke a few records. And that was, you know, my first taste of Paralympic Games. And then the Olympic Games in 2008 in Beijing.
Yeah.
And, you know, that was an experience of a lifetime. It was probably my worst experience ever.
Why?
And I swam the 10-kilometer event. It was extremely hot and I don't do heat. I was born in Cape Town. So,
yeah,
you know,
yeah,
the cold is where we grew
yeah.
up. And coming from 10K before the race, you know, my cap wasn't correct, so I had to try and change my cap and then take it off just before the start of the race. I wasn't actually allowed to go into the call-up room because I didn't have the right logos and, you know, the South African logo. So started the race, swam into the first buoy, cap came off, long hair, and lost the pack. You know, in open water, we try and draft off each other. So lost the pack, and all I knew was that I was going to finish this race. I don't think, I've never swum a race where I haven't finished. Was dehydrated. I mean, the water was over 30 degrees. It was over 40 degrees outside. So, I finished the race, and I placed 16th, and I think everything that could possibly go wrong went wrong.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But I know that I walk away from that with an experience.
Of course,
and,
yes.
And positive or negative, I went to the Olympics and it was my dream, and I realized my dream.
How important was it for you at the time to qualify for, I think, was it 800 meter able-bodied? Was it that important for you?
Well, you know, I'm a distance swimmer, so,
yeah.
you know, if you put me into a swimming pool and swim a 50 meter, which is 30 seconds, I'm absolutely useless. And saying useless in that, you know, from my start, from when the gun goes off, it takes me almost a second to react to the gun. So, you know, my muscles are not exactly very, very fast, but, you know, the longer distance was what I was going to swim, and I'd lost a leg, so it made more sense because your legs play a slightly less of a role. Although in the longer distances, they actually keep your balance.
Okay.
So, you know, it made more sense, 800 meters in the swimming pool, but then with all the turns and the girls became extremely, extremely fast. And then the 10 kilometer came up, which was the open water that would be at the Olympic Games. So I jumped again to the 10 kilometer
sure.
from the 800 meters
yeah.
and then focused more on open water
yeah.
And that event.
What other sporting interests do you have?
At school, I think I did every sport, you know, from athletics to...
If you didn't swim, what would you have done?
I would have probably been a musician.
Okay.
I did music as a subject, and I'd actually got into Beausoleil Music School in Cape Town.
Oh, wow.
And I wanted to play the bassoon. Yeah, so very strange instrument, but...
Speel jy hom nog steeds?
Ek het nog nie van die bassoon of gespeel nie, maar...
Ek weet nie wat die bassoon in Afrikaans is nie, gaan eerlijk is.
It's... I have absolutely no idea either, but I got into the music school for clarinet, which would be the first
beautiful.
Step, because I was still very short, young.
Yeah.
And from there, you would progress to the bassoon.
Yeah.
And yeah, I decided that my swimming was going to come first, so I decided not to go to Beausoleil Music School.
Tweet me asseblief, @MartinPester, wat is 'n bassoon in Afrikaans? Ek wil nou weet. South Africa seems to have a never-ending supply of amazing swimmers. I mean, we just keep churning them out, you know, from the Rex right through to the Natalies, the Chads. What is it? Is it the coaching level in this country, great up to standards, the facilities, which is lucky?
You know, I think as a swimmer and growing up, I was very young to begin at 6 years old. In our days, it was you get into a pool and you train. It was 2 hours a day. Well, when I started, it was 1 hour 3 times a week. Obviously, at age 8, 9, became 1 hour a day for the whole week. And as I got older, at 14, I started choosing an event and going specifically for that event, which what we would call majoring in an event.
Sure.
And I was an individual medley swimmer. So, you know, then I started training 2, 3, 4 hours a day. And at the end of the day, I think what I believed in was hard work. It was getting in and churning out the hours, churning out the mileage. You know, in open water, we believe that if you're going to race 10 kilometers, you have to train double that per day.
Sure.
So it's 20 kilometers a day, however long it takes to achieve
that. This is a mindset thing. It's just the way you grow up. A lot of people in this country just grow up with a mindset that's, you know, swim, the hard work,
We also have good coaches. You know, our coaches,
we have good coaches, have
produced you know, quite a lot of Olympic swimmers.
So
you know, from that perspective, you know, sports facilities, obviously there could be better. There could be more money. There could always be more and better. But again, it was a passion of mine, and I went out and I tried to achieve the best that I could achieve, and I wanted to.
Kyk jy rugby?
So 'n bietjie, ja.
So wie skree jy? Jy is 'n Kaapenaar, maar jy bly ons nou 'n
bietjie. Stormers. Ja.
Okay.
Ja.
Hoe lank bly jy nou in Johannesburg?
So 6 jaar.
Nee, ek hoor jou. Ek het groot geword in Weskaap en ek is nog altyd 'n bul geweest, so dit is fun. Ons maak nie verskonings daarvoor nie.
Yeah.
Cricket?
Cricket, the Proteas, obviously. You know, it sort of goes between the Cobras,
You know, it's weird for me, now we're mentioning cricket and rugby, you know, we do well internationally at cricket and rugby, but we do so well with swimming. Come on, we're competing and beating the best in the frickin' world with swimming, and it sometimes feels to me that the swim world doesn't get enough recognition and support for that.
It's, you know,
which door can I go and knock on?
There's so much that goes into it. You know, you've got your cricket, you've got your rugby. I think they run more as businesses where, you know, swimming's difficult to get people to come and watch it. It's boring.
Okay.
It's a very different industry. I think anything can happen.
Sure.
Anything is possible if you know, people want to do it and want to turn it around. At the moment, Senior Nationals is happening
in Durban.
In the 50-meter swimming pool, which, you know, obviously needs a little bit of work on it. But I think, you know, the swimmers are there and they're going to train and they're going to work hard no matter what.
Sure.
There's always steps to achieve to get to the Olympic Games, and obviously that's what they're going to do. But yeah, definitely, you know, more and better can always be there.
It's always important to strive for more. Would Swim SA ever see a female head like an athlete at all?
I think,
should
you know,
they?
A lot happens, and I think, you know, it's a tough industry to be in, a tough world to
Would
be
you
in
want
as
to
a
be
sports
in
person.
That side of it? Coaching maybe?
I've never wanted to coach.
Oh, okay.
Never. I see my role as something slightly different, and that is I'm more well, focused on areas of learning skills that you actually don't know that you learn while you're playing sport. So it can be any type of sport. But you know, finding a job later on in life, a lot of people say, but you have the skills. And you say, no, but what skills? Mm-hmm. And there's the tenacity, there's the hard work, there's the, you know, willing to start and end a project. You know, that is what sport teaches you. And that's what's important to me and what's been important to me my whole life.
Jesse Ikoon is Afrikaanse wereldwye ikoon with Freedom Day coming up as well, the 27th, I think, this month, and especially for women in our country. Do South African women empower themselves enough?
I think we're still stuck in a little bit of a rut, if I can call it that, but maybe not a rut. You know, we have a lot of women who are stepping out there and achieving and growing, and a lot of women are still saying yes, but you know, men are, they just have this power hungry and they go out and want to be the CEOs. And I just wish that all women would go out there and have this mentality that you have a goal and you have a dream and you can achieve that goal and dream. And yes, you're going to have a lot of people along the way that say you'll never make it, you'll never achieve this, you'll never achieve that. I mean, in my sport, I missed out. I had a motorbike accident and I still came back.
Sure.
And yes, it took me 8 years longer, but I still achieved it. And that's what women must realize, that anything is possible. As an individual, maybe not even as a woman, but as an individual, to go out and achieve your goals and dreams.
One of our viewer questions with the view of Freedom Day coming up on the 27th, do you remember the first time you voted?
I do, actually, which wasn't too far, well, wasn't too long ago. I was an ambassador for the IC for 5 years.
Yeah.
So I actually voted for the first time, when last election. So, an interesting day, interesting experience for me to go and stand in queues and go and vote and, have your fingerprint. And I think it's important to cast a vote and to have a say. And I'm also lucky that I'm part of that generation that believes in having a say.
Sure.
A lot of generations don't believe in that. So it's important to get out there and just have that say.
Lastly, you're booked as a motivational speaker as well. So I want you to tell me, how can South African women contribute more towards democracy? What is that one thing that is lacking? I think you mentioned it just now, it's the mindset, mind shift.
And belief, value
which
system
is exactly,
of belief.
Doesn't matter what comes your way, doesn't matter what your situation is, right?
Exactly. You know, you're always going to have people that are against you. You're always going to have people that say that, either you're a woman or you're too big or you're too small. It doesn't matter. Do you have a belief that you want to get somewhere? And as I said, it took me, I started at 6 years old swimming, and at 24 I achieved an Olympic dream. You know, that's a crazy amount of years, but I believed that I was going to achieve it, and I achieved it. And the feeling after achieving that is, it's indescribable. You can't describe it at all. And if I can share that with women and say, go out there and achieve something that you actually cannot describe, is phenomenal. And at the end of the day, you also have to work hard for that. You can't just think, this is going to happen and, I'm going to find my way somehow, somewhere, because someone's going to give me an opportunity. You have to go out and find those opportunities. And once you find those opportunities, you have to understand them and grab them. So I've been very fortunate to have found those opportunities and grabbed them and achieved everything that I wanted to. So to women out there, empower yourselves. Always grow, always learn. They say that women are more the nurturing type. So as the CEO, they would nurture more than just be dictators.
Mm-hmm.
Who knows? Who knows? Everybody's different. So have that goal, have that dream, and achieve what you want to achieve.
That's power right there, Natalie. Thank you so much for your time. Appreciate it. Lekker met de sin. Bye. Bye-bye, donkey.
Bye, donkey.